to you about neurons. These are, of course, these really cool molecules that allow animals to respond to information and to have behaviors. So we have the peripheral nervous system, and this is important for connecting the sensory receptors to the central nervous system, so getting sensory input through the afferent pathways, and then for the central nervous system to send information back to the tissues that act upon this information, like the muscles and the glands. And this is through the efferent pathways. And these are what produce motor outputs. So here's a neuron, which I'm sure you're all very familiar with. The first part is the part around the nucleus, and that's the soma or the cell body. And it's surrounded by all these little fuzzy things called dendrites. This is responsible for integration. And this is where the termini of other axons or other sensory receptors get onto the dendrites and collect information. And if enough of an electrical stimulus is generated, and then we have what's called spike initiation. So you can see that in this region here with the axon hillock, that's a region with a higher concentration of sodium channels. So if the signal is strong enough, it'll cause a depolarization in the axon hillock region. And then what happens from there is signal conduction, so that the signal is now propagated down the axon. And of course, the important players here, or parts of the morphology, are these myelin sheaths, which increase conduction rate, and they're separated by what's called these nodes of Ranvier. And finally, at the end, we have the termini, and that's where transmitter secretion occurs, so where they synapse onto other axons. Now, neurons can look really different, and they have lots of different shapes, and sometimes they have like two major ends, two short axons. They can be bipolar cells. They can just be primarily soma with dendrites, or they can have long axons. They can have, you know, an immense number of input connections, and like, for example, from the brain cell of a mammal. And they can also have extremely long axons, especially the ones that run from, you know, our brains down our spinal column into our muscles. So how do these things work? Well, they're called excitable cells, and so there's a lot of electrical activity within them. And if you are to put a recording electrode inside the cell and measure the difference with the extracellular environment, you see that there is a negative potential. The inside of a cell, of a neural cell, is more negative than outside. Okay, that's called a negative potential difference, and this is what also we call the resting membrane potential. How does this work? Well, something that might surprise you, but it's really cool, is that a key player is this semi-permeable membrane. And so it allows water to go through, but not certain charged particles. So if you think about this like a kind of like a battery cell, where we have a semi-permeable membrane that's only permeable to potassium, but in this case not to chloride. If we start off with equilibrium, that means that we have both, you know, the same concentration across the two sides of the semipermeable membrane. What's critical here is the balance between the electrical and the chemical potential. Okay, so what starts to happen is we have free diffusion, but only of the potassium. Okay, and at first, the electrical potential is equal across the two sides. However, if we somehow can change the potassium chloride concentration on the two sides of the semi-permeable membrane, what's going to happen? Well, an initially it's electrically neutral, but the potassium is going to start going across because, of course, the potassium concentration on the two sides are unequal. So potassium is going to move across to try to equilibrate the chemical potential. Of course, when that starts to happen, you're going to end up with more potassium on the right side than on the left. That, in turn, is going to set up an electrical gradient. So see, this is how, by manipulating the concentration between the two sides of the semipermeable membrane, by manipulating the concentration of the ions, and because it's only semipermeable, we can actually set up at both a chemical and an electrical gradient. And so if you're to measure that, you're going to see that that voltage difference across the two sides. Okay, so the equilibrium potential, that special term, is the potential at which the chemical work balances the electrical work. Okay, where the chemical work balances the electrical work. And this is the premise, or what the Nernst equation is based on, a balance between chemical and electrical work. Okay, so we have this negative potential inside and a positive potential outside the membrane. And surprisingly, if you look across the neurons of many, many animals across the tree of life, basically, they have pretty much the same voltage difference between the inside and the outside. The resting potential is roughly on the order of about negative 65 millivolts. Okay, so again, we have the soma, the dendrites, the axon, the nodes of Ranvier, the myelin sheath, integration, spike initiation, the axon hillock, signal conduction, and transmitter secretion. So how does it work? Okay, so if you have a stimulus, okay, it's going to start to open these gates in the membrane, and then you'll see a little signal. Now, so it's initiated by changes in the membrane potential. So the two kinds of signals that can come from a neuron, there's two types: graded and action potentials. Okay, so graded is what happens when you have a spike, but it's not enough to create an action potential. Okay, and so it causes depolarization or hyperpolarization, but it's sub-threshold, so it doesn't go to the all or none response. If, however, it crosses that threshold, it is going to generate an action potential, and it will be all or none. Okay, so there's two kinds of these signals in the nervous system: the graded potentials and the all or none. And the graded potentials are really important for gathering sensory information, because, of course, you don't want action potentials just generated willy-nilly. You want to be able to integrate the information and make basically rules about, you know, what you're going to respond to, because you don't want to respond inappropriately. Okay, so what do these potentials look like? Well, when you have a stimulus, you have a change in the membrane potential, and so you can actually measure this as a change in voltage over time. If you have, and this is a depolarization, if you have a bigger stimulus, you're going to get a bigger depolarization if it is a graded potential. Okay, so graded potentials have different voltage outputs for different amounts of stimuli. If you have a negative stimulus, you're going to get a hyperpolarization. Okay, it becomes more negative. Okay, so these are graded potentials, they're electrotonic, and they're passive. So that means that the change in the magnitude of the response is proportional to the stimulus, and but it decays over time. So if you look at that voltage change across the membrane, it reaches a peak, but then it diminishes down to nothing. Okay, so they decay with time and with distance. So action potentials look quite different. Okay, so if it's sub-threshold, it's going to be graded. But if it goes past that threshold, then bam, you get an action potential. And it's an active spike. It's all or none. So if it's sub-threshold, it just doesn't spike. But if it goes bigger than the threshold, it's still going to make the same size spike. And the important thing about action potentials is there is no decay. So that signal is going to travel down the axon at the same height. So how does this work? Well, it's got a very important player here is the sodium channel. It's a gated channel. And so what you see here in A is this closed gate. First, this membrane potential difference has to build up. Okay, but then at the red arrow, if there's a depolarization event, there's a big electrical signal that changes, causes a response to go above threshold, suddenly the activation gate in C opens. And what happens is suddenly the gate opens and the sodium can just flood through, which then causes a change in the membrane potential. Okay, that's going to cause the neighboring gates to open. Okay, but importantly, this doesn't just go on forever. This activation particle blocks the gate. So pretty soon, that flow is stopped, and then the gate closes. But what's happened is that the electrical difference has traveled down the membrane. Okay, so an action potential is driven by permeability and conductance. So this GNA is the electromotive force of the sodium channels. Okay, so the reason why the shape of the action potential is what it is because of these two kinds of gated channels, the sodium channel and the potassium channel. So the first channels to open are the sodium channels. Okay, and they go towards the equilibrium potential of the sodium channel. So the first phase of the action potential is the sodium activation, when the gates of the sodium channels open. Soon after that, the sodium channels become blocked. It's the sodium inactivation. And the GNA starts to go down, but the voltage continues to rise because at the same time, the potassium channels open. So they're a little bit slower, slightly slower than the sodium channels. But because they open, they contribute to the increase of the spike, because this is now the potassium channel activation. Then finally, those channels close, and then, okay. So why does it travel in one direction? Well, because the important thing is that those channels become deactivated. So when they open, they're going to activate the neighboring channels, but they soon become inactivated, so they can only travel along down in the direction of the axon where there's still fresh sodium and potassium channels. So the Hodgkin cycle. So this describes the opening of the sodium channels in the membrane, which then cause, so once those gates open, they're now permeable to sodium. That sodium permeability then causes all of those sodiums to flow into the cell, which then causes depolarization of the neighboring sodium channels, of the neighboring ion channels, which then causes those channels to open, which then causes more membrane permeability, and it goes on and on and on all the way down the axon. So this is a positive feedback cycle. And the voltage moves towards the equilibrium potential of the sodium channels. So this is a form of Ohm's law. Okay, so the GNA is the conductance of the sodium, and conductance is proportional to permeability. So, you know, when those channels open, they're permeable, and then that's reflected in the conductance, the electrical conductance. So I is current, V is voltage, and ENA is the chemical potential for the sodium from the ion concentration gradient across the membrane. Okay, so the voltage is moving towards the chemical potential for sodium. So the electromotive force of sodium is the voltage, membrane voltage, minus the chemical potential for the sodium, which is the driving force for sodium ions to cross the membrane. Okay, and these things cross when the channels are open. Okay, so current is proportional to GNA times voltage, membrane voltage, minus the ENA. Okay, can axons fire all the time? Well, you know the answer is no, right? But why? Well, there's an absolute refractory period where once you fire an axon, you cannot, no matter how much you stimulate it, it is not going to send another action potential. Just no way, uh-uh. After that, then when you stimulate again, you do get a small action potential or a small signal, but it's diminished, and it often requires a higher stimulus. So there's more current needed, and the signal is of reduced amplitude. So this is called the relative refractory period, where you can get something, but it takes more and it's smaller. Finally, after those two refractory periods are over, then when you stimulate again, you get the same action potential as you did before. Okay, and why do you have these refractory periods? Well, you know, right after an action potential is generated, you need time to rebuild those chemical gradients across the membrane, because that's what's driving the whole thing. So if it's all used up, nothing can happen. No matter how hard you beat that horse, it is just not going to move. After it's had a little bit of recharge, it can do something small, but it has to completely recover before it's back to normal. Okay, here's a whole bunch of information about action potentials, and I suggest that you pause the video and read this to yourself, because you certainly don't want to. Recharging the chemical gradient, potassium pump. There are these pumps in the membrane that will pump 3 sodiums and 2 potassiums across the membrane. It's working against the gradient, so of course it takes energy. It takes ATP to do this against the chemical gradient. There's also these potassium leak channels, and they're large, and they're permeable to potassium ions. So these just flow through as they wish. Okay, so I hope that helps you to understand how neurons work. And the next video that's going to be coming out is on signal propagation.